there's a few guards out there, like rock violets, and they're just like... Lunch? Like a broken man. Where did this whole fucking idea start? That's the thing. I was the classic kid who wanted to catch things. I was catching butterflies, I was catching frogs. We found this amazing nest in a tree and we thought, if we tie a spoon to a stick, shove it in the hole, we can come out with honey. So of course, you know, I did and got absolutely stung to bits. I guess I'm a wild honeybee conservationist. In some ways, I'm just going back to being a kid again. Like many people, I guess, we're worried about biodiversity decline and we all want to start doing our bit. And so I thought I'd become a beekeeper and very quickly realised it's quite an intensive hobby. Really, you're interfering and manipulating bees constantly. Epiphany really was finding wild nests in trees and actually just seeing that the bees survive. My reaction was to find a tree trunk, hollow it out, put it up into a tree. 2 weeks later, my young kid came back running. The bees have come, the bees have come. But it's that kind of excitement of seeing bees come in, choose something that you've made. Very different from catching a swarm and pushing them in. And so that's what's happened. I thought, we'll make another one. And I've been doing that ever since. So a log hive is basically a hollow log. The cavity is about the diameter of my hand span. And then it has a few entrance holes in it for the bees to find it. And it has a top with some insulation on that to keep things warm. And then a removable base, which is really purely for me because I love looking at the comb build coming down. But it's not just the honey we're interested in. You know, bees are living there year after year, and we just need to provide habitat. Luckily enough, I've got a workshop at home. In sort of October, I'll spend a month just on hackle making. It actually takes longer to make a hackle than it does to hollow a log. The reed comes from Norfolk, and then the legs are made out of sweet chestnut, which is coppiced from the Weald of Kent. It's basically, you know, the reed you see growing in estuaries. It's just got higher silicon than straw, so it lasts a lot longer. I'm very careful about where I buy my materials from for these hives that is sustainable, and I try and get 30 or 40 of those made and stored. When that's finished, the logs should come, and then I'm into the log hollowing. It's just nice to get a bit of chalk from the garden, and that's my tally. This is this year's hackle count, and then I need to make another 20 on here. Growing up on a farm, if the shearers always used to do the same thing with shearing sheep, and you'd have a tally board. You know, with the noise and the chainsaw and everything else, I soon got banished from the village and had to go up and find a farm to work on. The farmer's kindly lent me his Dutch barn, which is about a quarter mile up the road. It's just got plenty of space. I can make as much noise as I want. So the process really is to roll these heavy things up onto a trestle. The diameter really of the logs is associated to the diameter of the cavity that I'm making. Fundamentally, it's about insulation and its thermodynamics. And then with a chainsaw, I can basically cut a square hole through from working either end with the saw. And that leaves me with four segments that have to be cut out. And for me, the easiest way still is to do it with these 6 foot long gouges. This one was made by a guy in his late 70s, a guy called Hector Cole, who's like the master blacksmith in the country. This one's made by a younger guy who's in his 30s, and it's a little bit cruder. He's just squashed the steel. But actually, it's my favourite gouge now, so. But it's just having that steel gives momentum when you're doing it. You know, I'm getting old, so if I can get four logs done, log, tea break, log, lunch, log, tea break, log, end of day. Oh, I've got a bit more. It's a bit depressing sometimes. You go around and there's still a bit more to go. Kids, like anyone who works outside in this cold, you're knackered and fall asleep in your tea at this time of year, and then you have that extra energy in the summer. I quite like all that. There's something really nice about getting a tree trunk and with a few tools, a long gouge and a chainsaw, I can do them. I can do them anywhere, so it meant that I can teach other people. So that the whole point is that I wasn't just this one-person mission to save the planet. Basically, around the 1st, 2nd of February is when you might get your first bit of pollen, a bit of hazel pollen or a bit of snowdrops coming in, and the bees are suddenly thinking about spring. The year moves quite quickly. Suddenly, it'll be the end of April, May, the populations be large, and they're thinking about splitting, reproducing. And at which time, I'll start putting the nests up in end of March, April, so that there's new cavities for them to look for. We're in a farm in Wiltshire today where, as the years pass, the bees are going to be established here. They're not moving anywhere, and they're going to grow with the woodland. Well, but one thing this woodland won't have, perhaps for 100 or 150 years, is habitat for bees, you know, a cavity. I have a compass with me, and what I want to do is set up the sort of entrance holes so they're looking sort of south, southeast. And one of the reasons for that is in, say, like February, March, where you might just get sun briefly for an hour or so a day, those bees are going to get that light. A bit like, you know, when we have a house, it's quite nice to have the morning light to get us going in the morning. Yeah, this is propolis. This is propolis resin. Scratch it on like a crayon. And it's really cool. This stuff, I don't know if you can smell it, but it's antibacterial, antimicrobial, antiviral. It's like a super, it's like effectively like an external immune system that the bees make. This is the real good stuff. This is propolis tincture. So this is propolis dissolved in alcohol.
So you're just knocking that back?
I knock it back. And it just, it's really good. So that boosts our immune system.
Love that.
It's good stuff. Rubbing. Okay. Part of the whole process was working out by myself how to lift these, you know, logs that could be up to 80 kilos. Up into a tree, or lifting a rocket hive, which is again on legs, a lot of weight to push up. But now I'm paying penance for. I put these hives all around the country, and I've probably put up about 800 now, and wherever I go, bees come and they're surviving. Most of my life I've been building interiors of boats where beauty is very much part of what I'm involved with. So the idea of a log hive has still got to be a beautiful structure. I think by doing so, the person who's investing money into it, if they can have something that's beautiful in their, on their land, they're already sold. You know, the story's already there and they like it as a bit of sculpture. And then when the bees come, they're ecstatic. You have to keep pumping it, otherwise, just when you need it, it dies out. I'm really trying to feel their mood. If they're going to be aggressive, then they'll come and get me now. So, still to this day, there'll be beekeepers saying that wild bees don't exist, and what I'm doing is actually aiding disease and affecting the British commercial bee colonies, which, of course, is not true. I'm often asked what motivates me to do what I'm doing, and it certainly isn't money, and it certainly isn't an easy life. You know, I'm I'm getting on a bit and it's physical work. Putting up these hives is great. They're beautiful things. Getting bees is a really, really important thing. But what is exciting is that people start with the bees and then they're drawn into conserving everything else. People stop and look and allow themselves to stop long enough to start seeing other things. It might start with bees, and from my point of view, it's really important to think about the wild or the three living bee in terms of genetics. We need strong, resilient bees. But actually, we also need people who are going to be switched on by everything else in nature and want to conserve and want to plant trees and look at butterflies, look at fungi, look at everything. That's been really powerful that I hadn't expected when I started this adventure 15 years ago. That we're up against the bee industry, but nature is telling us a different story every time. We come across a nest that should be dead and it's just thriving, it's just buzzing. And you know, that's all you need. You don't need someone in a hall telling you a bit of scientific nonsense that doesn't exist. We see it every day. And that's what drives us to put more up. So I think, you know, early on I said I'm not a beekeeper, and maybe I'm a honeybee conservationist, but actually it's about everything.